Welcome everyone to my Mezca Sosa guide for the Elsewhere patch. It's going to be a bit different than the one I did before in Redstone, because there I only presented some builds really quickly, but now I'm going to give you some general advice first, and then I'm going to show you specific builds. Just like in Redstone, I'll be having two pet sword builds, two non-pet builds, a pet sword petcon build and a non-pet dueling build. I will have descriptions of the builds on my Discord with a link to the build editor page. I will also have this on YouTube, so if you want to check it out, in the YouTube description I mean. So if you want to check it out really quickly, just go over it at your own pace. You can just go to the description, click on the link, and you will see the builds I will present. Of course, I can't do that for the advice, so I'm going to just start off with that and talk about that. So first of all, there are some changes, of course, to Mezca Sorcerer in the Elsewhere patch that make it play a little bit different than in Redstone. An important one is the so-called Haunt Ward nerf. It's not really a nerf, it's more a bug fix, but the Haunt Ward got a reduced size now. It used to give like 40% extra on you, and now it only gives 20%. Regardless, it's a smaller shield now. And the main result of that is that I'm going to be having to put more Maximum Magicka in my builds. As you can see here already, I have 44k Maximum Magicka, whereas in last patch I'd be sitting around 39 to 40k. Sometimes there will also be a higher CP count in the Bastion passive, but more about that later. Of course, I'm still using 3 shields, so it's actually not entirely bad, this so-called nerf, because I have to put extra into Magicka, I also get a larger Harness Ward and Harness Magicka and Healing Ward than before, so it's not entirely bad. Hardened does remain a better shield than Dampened Magic, however. Dampened Magic didn't get any nerfs or reduced shield sizes, but it does still cost a lot more, and since you are spamming the main shield, you don't want to be doing that with Dampened too much, since you will drain your Magicka way quicker than with Hardened Ward. Another thing about the shields, of course, is a commonly asked question, the shield order. So which shield to cast first and which shields to cast afterwards. There are pet builds and there are non-pet builds. In the pet builds you don't have healing ward, and in the non-pet builds you do have healing ward. So starting out with the pet builds, you simply cast Haunt Ward and Harness Magicka first. And if you have a non-pet build, you cast healing ward as last skill. The reason for that is that the first shield you cast will be the one that gets taken down first as well, when you get damaged. So if I cast Hardened Ward first and only after that Harness Magicka, the Hardened Ward is going to go down first, the Harness Magicka is going to go down afterwards, and while the Hardened Ward is getting damaged, the Harness Magicka will give back the Magicka as well. So that's a good reason to cast this as a second shield. Also, it's smaller, of course, so it's not really that good for an instant defense. Healing Ward, I cast this last because it is protected by the other two shields then, and it's easier, way easier, to get the heal off. If you cast it first, of course it will be taken down first and you won't get the heal from it. Next thing I want to talk about is the Resto Ult nerf. Basically, before we had a morph that gave major protection, they took the major protection away, and now it only gives the extra healing on the other morph, but it only gives the healing and the extra crit damage. This means that we will have to change to the life giver morph now, because the crit damage you get on the other morph isn't worth that much, and the loss of major protection is really noticeable, making this one the stronger option for defense. If you look at it, you also cast Generation, Blessing of Protection and Steadfast Ward at no cost when you cast this ultimate. It means that it will be better for defense, for like instant healing or life saving, but it won't be as good for applying pressure on enemies anymore, because you don't have the long duration of major protection, you cannot tank as many people. But it is better for getting your health up really quickly and getting out of a group that jump on you, like getting out really quick. This thing can be resolved if you use like large resistances or Pyre Skeleton or something, because you can still get major protection and stuff when you cast the Life Giver ult, and that is the only option where you can still treat it like the other morph from before and push enemies with this ult. But in general, it's not gonna work anymore. The last thing I want to say about the Resto ult is that it casts the actual morphs of the abilities, so make sure to have them morphed, it's going to be much stronger then. I recommend Rapid Regeneration, Combat Prayer and of course Healing Ward as morphs for these skills. Combat Prayer is also going to increase your damage a little bit, which is also useful if you do decide to pressure an enemy a little bit while you have it up. Yeah, then the next thing they changed, well, they didn't really change it, they just implemented it by accident, is the streak bug here. As of this patch, the streak bug got a bit worse than the last patches. It's going to be more frequent. If you streak to someone that is behind LOS, you will root yourself for a short bit and then you can move again. Now, unfortunately, it does make some clunky animations for the enemies that watch you streak. You like streak forward a little bit and then you teleport backwards, which is a bit different than, of course, than a pure root. You don't actually stand still for the game, you do move a little bit, but for your screen it does look like you are rooted. However, this bug can be avoided if you don't streak to enemies behind LOS. I mean, there's not much use doing this anyway, but next to that, also don't streak into towers or keeps when there are people below or above you, because then you will get rooted as well. If you just keep mind of when this bug can occur and you avoid streaking, then it's going to be a much easier thing to deal with. The main reason I keep on running streak these days is because of its stun. It got buffed and the elsewhere patch is going to be 3 seconds now, which actually makes it a pretty good stun since it's also undodgeable. In general, this stun is a great tool to get out of a group as well, so for like defensive purposes already. It gives you the time you need to cast more streaks if you stun the group, and like by the time the enemies break free and turn their camera, I'm already far away. I can also sort of mimic Ball of Lightning, which is the other morph with streak, by doing a roll dodge into the streak. So as you probably know, Ball of Lightning is going to absorb projectiles, but if I do a roll dodge into the streak, I'm actually going to dodge all those projectiles, making it act like a Ball of Lightning. Of course, this also works for stamina-based projectiles. I'm just going to do one right here. As you can see, my stamina bar got drained a little bit, but you didn't see any animation, but I did do a roll dodge into the streak. This means that while I am streaking, I'm going to dodge all the attacks that were fired at me. So as I mentioned, for the offensive capabilities, streak can also be used as a stun. It has some benefits and drawbacks over using reach. Usually Sorks were using this stun over here, reach with the Master Staff, as a spammable. I still have two builds with that, but I also have two builds that use streak as a main stun. Of course, you need to be rather close to the target if you want to be using this stun, which then requires you to have some decent stamina sustain to deal with it. It's also a bit harder to kill people that run away all the time, since, well, you have to streak towards them and then streak through them as well to stun them, which can be like a huge drain on your magicka. Also, if you're purely using streak and nothing else, you obviously don't have a ranged stun, but I did counter that a little bit with going with the tactician passive over here. This here, which sets the enemy off balance when I use roll dodge. Now, what this does, a roll dodge, somebody's casting a projectile at me, then the enemy is going to be put off balance, and if I then follow it up with a medium heavy attack, so like it's simply like very partly charged heavy attack, is going to CC the enemy, which is quite a great tool to get an like really unexpected CC from range. Especially when you are kiting and there's a whole bunch of people chasing you, this can be a really great tool to kill someone. And of course, just like if you're using this the streak as main stun, you do need to have some decent stamina sustained for that. So as you can see in this build right here, I do have quite a lot of it, though I do still have a lot of the other sustains as well. But yeah, you got to keep in mind that you can't just go with like 10k stamina and expect to be using streak and tactician as a regular stun. Now, some other benefits of using streak as a main stun is, of course, it frees you up to use another 5-piece set, because usually if you go with reach, you have to use the Master Inferno Staff and you have to use a backbar set. Sorks have been stuck in this sort of setup for a while now, with Leech on the backbar, then a 5-piece set on here, a monster set and a Master Staff. But if you run streak, you can actually like open up the horizon for builds by a large part. You can run 5-5-2 setups right now, which means you run a 5-piece armor set, then a 5-piece on the jewelry and the weapons, and then a 2-piece monster set. There's a huge amount of viable sets you can use for this. I also have two builds with that kind of setup. Another benefit of using streak as the main stun is the fact that I can use another spammable now instead of reach. I've gone for elemental weapon, which deals more damage, costs less than reach, and it's also like harder to see it coming, because of course you cast a light attack and only after that you will cast the elemental weapon, and it will charge the light attack that is already going with more damage and can create some huge burst like that. It can be used as spammable and as burst, Obviously, if you use Desert Palm to just do light attack, elemental weapon, light attack, elemental weapon, like this, it will charge up the light attack that's already firing. But you can also use it as a burst tool, simply by not casting the light attack before you cast elemental weapon, and then casting a light attack afterwards with a fragment or a finisher or whatever. And that's a great way of making like extra burst, which is also a benefit, of course, of elemental weapon, which is something you don't have if you're using Reach. Then, the next skill I have to talk about, of course, is Curse. I mean, it's your main burst skill. Now, there are obviously two morphs to this. There is Daedric Prey and there is Haunting Curse. I'm always using Haunting Curse, also on pet builds, simply because it's a really quick burst. It fits Sorcerer much better. The second explosion can also be really useful for catching enemies off guard. Most people don't see it coming, the second explosion, so it's a really great tool of killing like Nightblades or something that are pretty good at predicting the first curse explosion, but not in the second one. That being said, the Daedric Prey morph is definitely still good for pet builds as well. If you're running the Twilight and Atronach, you get the Daedric Prey on top of that as well. You're going to have some huge pressures, especially if you're in like a really small fight, 1v1, 1v2, something like that. Of course, you gotta keep in mind, in open world, you don't have that very often. Mostly you're fighting large groups or Zergs, and in that case, Haunting Curse is definitely the better option because of the quick burst it gives. Then the next skill I definitely need to mention is Boundless Storm. It already got a bit of a cost reduction last patch, and its function is still the same, but I do feel like I need to say that it is important to have this on your bar, because of the major expedition it gives, and the fact that you can sprint with it a little bit and you get really far up on stairs or downhill or whatever, basically in situations where you cannot use streak or your streak will be bugged. If that happens, I'm going to try and use Boundless Storm, do a short sprint. For example, in this ramp up here, if I streak up on it, you can see it's going to be really slow. The streak doesn't go far at all. It takes me like 3 streaks to get up this hill over here. But if I use Boundless Storm, I just sprint a little bit. I have a very small stamina drain, and I don't waste any magicka like this. And it's about equally fast, so it's definitely worth using Boundless Storm then. It's also good if you want to get like behind an LOS really quickly. If you do streak, you're gonna have to do one streak and you're overextending a little bit and then you go back. But if you do Boundless Storm, obviously you just do Boundless Storm, you do a quick sprint around this thing. It's way quicker than using streak, so it's definitely worth slotting it and not like dropping it with Mighty Chudin, of course. I mean, you can still do it, but you lose this ability to go and like seek LOS or go uphill or downhill really quickly. The next skill I need to talk about is Fury. They gave it a bit more magicka sustain this patch, and they also fixed a small bug that would allow an enemy to dodge it, dodge the explosion itself. But in actual use, it's not much different as in last patches. I'm using Fury mostly for the extra burst it gives. I'm not using it as a finisher. That's really important to remember. Fury is not very good as a finisher, simply because it has a delay before it hits. If I cast it here, you see it takes like a second before it hits. So that makes it like a really bad skill purely as a finisher. Its strength is really in the fact that if you apply it, it then goes and applies an explosion that will pop if the enemy goes below 20% health, and this will add a huge amount of extra burst to your build. For example, if I just do a quick combo here, Curse into Fury into Streak into Frags, you can see that everything explodes at the same time. You get the Frags, you get the Curse explosion, and if explosion is applied then as well, you only need to get the enemy to 20% health, this thing will pop as well and he will die instantly because it deals some decent damage after all. Also, keep in mind that it restores like almost 5k magicka this patch, which is actually quite big. It's going to, like, if you get a lot of kills, you're going to get a lot of magicka regeneration out of that as well. Which makes it really worth using Streak for the extra burst it gives. If you use purely Reach, or you slot Elemental Drain or Mage Light or whatever, it's not going to be as much of a burst as it is right now. Then, of course, another important skill that you will use on non-pet builds is Healing Ward. As I mentioned before, you need to cast this as a second or a third shield, not as a first shield, because then you won't get the heal. It did get a bit of a nerf in Murkmire, makes it a bit worse, but it is still viable to use this as healing in conversion, in combination with Dark Conversion here and the Resto ult. Definitely still works as a healing skill then, it's just not as good as before, of course. Now, an important division in Sorc builds, of course, is the pet builds versus the no pet builds. Let me say first of all that using Aatronark is always a good option, whether you're running a pet build or not. It's probably the best sorcerer, pure sorcerer ultimate out there right now for open world. Deals a good amount of burst damage, CCs, and is also going to be a lot of pressure on the enemy. Now, when I say pet build, most people are talking about slotting the Twilight, of course. This thing here, using this as a main heal and also as the extra for the extra pressure it gives. Yeah, as I said, it gives more pressure, it gives more healing. The problem is that it can be killed though. A single like Zergling that uses his brain can give you a very hard time in 1v1 if he's killing the pet over and over and over again, because then you are purely busy with resummoning and protecting the pet. It's also less good for kiting. It's going to always like stay behind you. And if any of you take damage from the Zerg that is chasing you, it's going to be the pet, it's going to be down again. And if you start resummoning it, then you're obviously going to be very slow. And it's not very good for kiting to do that, obviously. Now, that being said, pet builds do have a lot of benefits as well. It's going to give you more stats because you can run sets like Necropotence. You're going to get the extra health from the passives here. This one, 8% extra health, definitely worth it. And as we said before, easy healing and easy pressure. That's also why I have two pet builds and two non-pet builds for open world. I think they are equally good to run, both with their benefits and drawbacks. In dueling, obviously pet builds are better, but most like organized duel tournaments don't allow you to use them, which is the reason I have a no-pet dueling build included in this guide. Now, a last thing I need to mention about the pet builds, of course, is that you need to double bar this thing, which means that you are going to lose a skill. For most people, this is going to be Endless Fury. Of course, you are making a sacrifice with that, but you do get a lot back in terms of pressure with the Twilight. So, now for the builds. First, a few general things I have to mention that counts for just about every build I will show now. Is the potions that I use. I'm using the spell power potions, which will give me the major prophecy, the major sorcery I need. Frees up basically two skill slots, quite useful. The extra stamina regen is something I get from using sword and bolt heavy attacks or just Shackle Breaker or whatever. I do have an add-on that lets me switch between tripods and spell power potions. I can use like tripods when I'm under heavy pressure and I just want to get out. It's quite useful to switch to that then. Then for Vampire, I used to run Vampire on most of my builds last patch, but I have dropped it now because I can often get way higher stats, and with the DK buffs that are here right now, it's not a very wise idea to run Vampire anymore. So I do advise against running it right now. So for the builds that I'm going to run, these are the best builds I have found so far in this patch. These are obviously not the only builds you can use. You can switch out sets as much as you like. I will mention some options you can go for at the end of the video as well. I did try with these builds to get one from every possible playstyle, like pets, no pets, with reach, without reach, etc. Obviously, I have my ideal enchant, Mundus setup, etc. But you gotta keep in mind that this is what I prefer. Like, if I have, say, 1.7k regeneration, that is what I feel comfortable with. That's the amount of enchants I need to get 1.7k is what I feel comfortable with. It can be different from you. It can be that you can play with less regen or more regen. Simply change out enchantments or Mundus, swap them around a little bit until you get something that you like. As I mentioned before, these builds are all on the build editor links I have in the description on my Discord. Then, for the first build that I have, is basically a pure stat build. I am going to focus as much in stats as I can. It is a pet build. I'm running Necropotence and Brightos Burst here. So, Brightos Burst going to give me a lot of magicka and magicka regeneration, Necropotence even further buffing the magicka. I'm using the infusion drink here, which is spring-loaded infusion, which is going to give me almost the stats of Trifood. I should show it in the inventory actually, because the tooltips are a bit different. Like, here we go. These are the actual stats it gives. It is almost like Trifood. The difference is like 300 or something in the tooltip, but you are able to run a good set like Bratwurst with this, so it's definitely worth going for it. As you can see, with these sets, I get over 50k magicka on both bars while keeping a decent amount of magicka regeneration, spell damage, health, and stamina sustain. Now I am using the Inferno Staff of Necropotence, infused with a shock glyph on the front bar, a sword and board of Necropotence on the back bar, and Bloodspawn. Bloodspawn is really nice for pet builds to get a high Aatrox uptime, which works really nice with the Twilight as well. If you have both pets up, you're going to take much less damage because they LOS you, basically. It's also going to give some of the extra magic stamina regeneration. I have almost 15k stam, which you might consider high or low, I do not know, but in my case, I do like to have a bit of extra stamina regeneration then, which is a good point for running Bloodspawn. If you want, you can go with another monster set though. You can go with Pyroskeleton, Engine Guardian and such. Definitely, this is a big bonus of monster sets, is that you can switch it out for whatever you like. Now, I did mention I have an infused Shocklift on the Inferno Staff. This build does not use the Master Staff, and so does not use Reach. It uses Elemental Weapon as a spammable, which is, if I do that, I'm going to go with Infused Shock Damage Glyphs. If I'm running a weapon skill as a spammable, I go with Sharpened and Escapist's Poisons, as you can see here, these poisons. But since I'm using Elemental Weapon, which is not a weapon skill, ironically, it's not going to proc the poison as much. As you can see, it has a chance to proc it, while an enchant is like guaranteed to proc. And this like shock damage, infused shock damage, is definitely going to add a lot of burst to your rotations. And it's also going to proc minor vulnerability. Some things have changed with the calculations in all of those like vulnerability things, which actually makes it a very strong option, this shocklift, because of the minor vulnerability it gives. As I mentioned before, I do have the highest stats you can possibly get with a Magicka Sorcerer with this build. The drawback is, of course, that you cannot use Reach if you'd like to, so you are relying on Streak and Tactician as your CCs. Which is also a reason why I have the increased stamina sustain. You can also improve your stamina sustain quite a bit by using the Sword and Board heavy attacks in your rotation. Like if there's somebody in your face all the time and you're not under too much pressure, you can do a quick Sword and Board heavy attack. It's going to give you a lot of extra stamina sustain like that. Definitely not to be underestimated. For the skills, as you can see here, I have the classic burst combo, of course. I have Streak to stun, Fragments, Elemental Weapon, Curse. You can use Daedric Prey here, as I mentioned before, but I prefer Haunting Curse. Then the pets, I have slotted them here. Now for the ultimates, that's the most important thing to mention here. You have Aatrox, obviously, and this is also a build where I can use Undo on the back bar. It's quite useful for Sword and Board because obviously you're going to block with this when you're under heavy pressure, and if you get a shield right when you block under heavy pressure, it's quite useful. So Undo is a big reason for this. Obviously, you can also use Undo still for the mobility it gives, like so. Going to like allow you to kite somebody all the way over there and then go back, quite nice. But you do have to keep in mind that this skill is still bugged. It's been bugged for a while right now, but it has a chance that it does not work. So you just cast the undo and you stay on place. You just do a little animation, but you stay on place. So keep in mind that that can happen, which is a bit of a drawback on undo, but still with the other buffs it gives on the shield, it's quite nice. So, for the champion points in this build, I'm going to start out with the green tree. I have 56 into Warlord, always have a good amount into this champion point. 75 into Arcanist is the most important like green champion point passive you have, so I always put a lot of points into this passive. You notice I only go to 14% and not to 14.07, which would make more sense considering the jump points. But the jump points don't actually count on this particular percentage, so if you go to 14% you actually get it. While in other like passives, sometimes if you go to 14% you go to 13%, but it's not the case here. 56 into Mooncalf, I mean, always useful to have some good stamina regeneration. 52 in Tumbling and 31 into Shadow Ward. It's one of the two builds I have a decent amount of points into Shadow Ward, obviously for the blocking. And for the blue tree, 48 into Elfborn. Keep in mind this is also going to buff your healing from the Twilight pet. If that crits, it also gets the bonus from 18%. For 56 into Elemental Expert, 46 into Spell Erosion, 81 and 39 here. I've gone to 120 points here, which is important to get the Tactician passive. As I mentioned before, I am going to need this to do a bit of range stuns in combination with Streak for the close range stuns. Nothing into the Ritual. For the red trees, 56 into Ironclad, 40 into Resistant, 56 into Thickskinned, 49 in these two. It's important to get Unchained. When you break free, basically the cost of your next dark conversion is going to be reduced by 80%, making it practically free. So it's quite important to get this champion point passive. It's not very hard to get it either, because there are some like really strong passives over here. So yeah, keep in mind that you have Unchained and use it as well. When you break free, do a shield and cast a dark conversion afterwards, because it's basically free then. Then 20 into Bastion, you can see you've gone up to 9% here. This is just enough like champion points into Bastion to get my shield to 50% of my health. As it states in the description of the shield, of course, it goes to a maximum 50% of your health. The Magicka I have, in combination with the high health, is going to give me a very large shield, but with the 9% extra from Bastion, I'm going to get this like to 49 and something percent of my max health, so it's quite useful. And I do prefer putting these points into Bastion instead of like Resistant or something, or other red passive. Simply because if you just start out with a champion points passive, the first few points you put into there get a huge amount of a bonus. Now for the second build, this is also a pet build, but this one is reliant on reach. It's basically the same one as I had in my last guide. It is just the classic Necropotence with Lich on the back bar and then Bloodspawn. Now, this is a very well-rounded build. I mean, it has a good CC, it has a good pet heals, the regeneration with Lich and the base regeneration is very good as well. And the damage also is really good, so definitely a good option to go with this pet build over here. It does have a little bit less stats than the first build, of course, but in exchange you get reach. Now, the enchants are full maximum Magicka. Bloodspawn is optional, you can also use Pyroskeleton, Engine Guardian, Zahn, etc. Using Sword and Board on the back bar again, of course, there's no really need for a Resto Staff. You can use the heavy attacks from the Sword and Board to get some extra stamina sustain. For the front bar, I do like to use Escapist Poisons, actually. As I mentioned before, this is what I like to run if I have a weapon skill as a spammable. In this case, this is Reach. The Escapist Poisons are going to give me a good control over the target, but more importantly, it's going to give me a really high uptime on CC immunity. Allowing me to finish bursts or to be able to keep on fighting without having to spend general cooldowns breaking free. So it's quite a time saver, this one. Definitely worth a try. I do not recommend running any other poisons here, like you could run the regeneration poison or the double dot poison. But in that case, you're better off running the infused shock cliff. Only the escapist poison, I think, makes it worth running a sharpened staff with poisons. For the skills, of course I have still the pets instead of Fury and instead of Healing Ward, I use Reach as a spammable. And I also have Undo on the back bar here with Etronach on the front bar, and you can use Daedric Prey just like in the previous build. For the champion points, starting out with the blue tree, I have 56 over here. I'm just going to go over them, I've already explained most of this before. I don't need Tactician for this build, of course. Nothing into Ritual. Keep in mind that you have Unchained, of course. Bastion here is not going to bring your shields to just about 50% of your health. It's a bit lower, but I don't really want to put more points into Bastion simply because of the diminishing returns. And then I also have a decent amount into Shadow Ward again, just to be able to hold that block longer. The third build is the first non-pet build I will be presenting. It is basically the successor of the classic Shackle Lich build from last patches, but now I am using Praetor's Boast instead. But as I said, the Lich is still here, the Master Staff is still here, and the monster set, which is optional, can be Bloodspawn, Pyroskeleton, Engine Guardian or Zahn, depending on what you feel best with. Now I've gone with Praetor's Boast again with the Infusion Food, simply because it gives more stats, it gives more maximum Magicka, spell damage and Magicka regeneration than the Shackle Breaker and Thrive Food give, at the cost of a bit of stamina. But I felt last patch that with the Shackle Breaker and Thrive Food setup that gave like 18k stamina, I was overkilling it. Certainly because this is a Reach build and it doesn't need as much stamina regeneration as a Streak build would need. Now for the enchants, I have all maximum Magicka enchants except for one here, that is a Tristat. That's simply to get my stamina over 15k to be comfortable with, and also to buff my health a little bit, so I get like 23.5k in PvP, which is like the ideal point for me. On the Master Staff, I am using the Escapist Poison. As I mentioned before, if I'm using a weapon skill as a spam bull, I prefer to use the Escapist Poison over here. As on the back bar, I have Defending Restoration Staff with the Damage Shield enchant, Glyph of Hardening. For the Mundus, again, I have the Mage over here. The skills, yeah, I have Reach, of course, with Fury. I've put Aetherlock on the front bar and Resto and the Lifegiver Ultimate on the back bar. It's the best ultimate setup, I think, for this. Aetherlock is good for sustained fights, the Resto ult is good for life-saving, panic button, stuff like that. Again, in combination with Healing Ward and Dark Conversion. For the champion points, I'm just going to go over them quickly. I've already explained most of this previously. I have 61 into Warlord, 64, 75 here, 66 into Tumbling. I do want a decent amount of capability to roll dodge, since this build is a non-pet build, so your stamina is used for rolling and breaking free mostly, not for blocking. Then for the blue trees, the main difference is that I don't need the Tactician anymore with this build because I've reached SCC. So I've dropped a lot of points, I've removed a lot of points from Staff Expert, and I've divided those amongst the Elfborn, Elemental Expert and Spell Erosion over here. Then nothing in the Ritual as per usual. In the Steed, I have 52 here, 37 here. Again, 52, the same as in the Ironclad in the Thickskinned, 49 in these two. And 31 into Bastion. As per usual, this gets my shield to just about 50% of my health, which is, I think, the optimal distribution of CP. Then for the final open world build, I have my personal favorite, which is 5 Chakrabreaker and 5 Bractor's Boast in combination with 2 Bloodspawn. This is a build without reach and without pets, so it's using the Streak CC. I think it's pretty effective. It has a lot of general like regeneration, sustain and damage, and it's just been the most fun to play for me in this patch. All the enchants are Magicka except for one over here that is in the that's the Tristat enchant, just in order to get a bit more health and a stamina for the sustain. As you can see, I have quite a lot of stamina sustain. Again, this is to be able to play with Streak and Tactician consistently. For the traits, I have, well, full impenetrable, of course, and an infused shock damage glyph on the destruction staff and a defending hardened glyph on the restoration staff. Now, as I said before, I prefer to use the infused shock damage if I'm not using a weapon spammable, which is the case for this build. I'm again using elemental weapon. I'm using almost the same setup as in the previous build, but yeah, instead of Reach I have Elemental Weapon, but I still have the Greater Storm Aetherlock for front bar and the Restoration ult for the back bar. The Storm Aetherlock is quite good to play with, is quite good in combination with Streak as a stun, because you can basically hide behind the thing and then go and streak out of it to stun someone. And the Aetherlock by itself can also be used as a really good stun and burst combo. As you can see, it deals almost 10k. Damage on impact. For the champion points in this setup, it is almost identical as in the one before. For the red and the green trees, I'll just go over them really quick. It's about exactly the same. But for the blue trees, I do want to have Tactician for this build over here in order to get the CC with a heavy attack, so I did change the CPs a little bit in order to get 120 points here. Now for the dueling build, I actually already have a video on this one uploaded on YouTube. I'm not going to present it again because literally nothing has changed for this patch except for a bit of extra CP into Bastion. But if you want to see what that is, I have the link to the video in the description. So you can go and check that out. I also have a video where I fight in a tournament with that build if you want to see how it's played a little bit. But yeah, check out the description or the Discord if you want to see the dueling build. Lastly, I also have a battleground build for you. But before I get into the exact setup, I do want to mention that this build is heavily group focused. You can always go in battlegrounds with like any of the Cyrodiil builds I have provided, and you can just switch a few enchants to have the extra magic regeneration, etc. But usually that sort of build is still going to rely on, well, kiting around very much, even in the battleground. And it's going to be less useful like in the actual group setting, group versus group, primate versus primate sort of setting. Which is why I have created this build as well, in order to be able to roll with all the wardens, templars, and etc. and stick with them. And also supporting them. Now, the build is 5 heavy armor. That is already an important factor in making this build more viable for the really group versus group playstyle. Simply because heavy armor gives you the more gives you the extra resistances. It's going to allow you to survive enemy ult bombs. It's as simple as that. So it's 5 to expect with the staves over here in infused, and 5 necropotence in combination with 2 engine guardian. Now engine guardian again can be changed, but it's just because of the no CP regeneration loss that I prefer to run a regeneration set over here. To expect, as I said, it was infused. On the front bar I have a shock damage cliff. This is going to proc a lot, of course. It's a proc damage as well, which is very strong in no CP. On the back bar I have the regeneration enchant, which is basically going to give me about 600 magicka per second, because I'm going to proc this thing with Wall of Elements on the back bar. Now if I cast this thing and I swap to the front bar, it's still going to be proccing the back bar enchant, as well as the front bar enchant with your with your light attacks and all. Now this means that you will get about 1.2k magic regeneration simply from this enchant, which is quite strong. Next to that, for the enchantments, I have 3 regeneration enchants over here, just to get about 1.5k magic recovery. You can go lower if you feel like it. In combination with this, it's definitely viable to do so, I think. For the armor enchant, they are full maximum magicka. In combination with necropotence, I get a decent magicka pool for no CP, while keeping a decent amount of damage and regeneration as well. As you can see, I have 25k health. Now, you do have to keep in mind that this is with the Emperor buff from this campaign. They just happen to have it now, so in reality this is going to be more like 23k or something. Now the idea of this build is that, well, you will support the group as much as possible, and a important factor in that is the backbar ice staff with Wall of Elements and Icy Rage. This is going to be a huge help into controlling enemy groups. If you throw down the blockade of frost in combination with this ultimate, it's going to like split apart an enemy primate instantly, and it also synergizes great with like ults from your teammates. Also the Twilight, I'm running a pet build here as you probably see. I prefer using this over Healing Ward simply because it heals to other targets, so it's quite useful for supporting the group even more. Next to that, I do keep on using Streak and Conversion, of course. Streak is just great as an AoE stun, which is a very important use, I think, in Battlegrounds. It's the only spammable AoE stun, so it's quite strong. And then Dark Conversion I still need for the magic regeneration, of course. As a spammable, I have Elemental Weapon here, but you can also use Force Pulse or Reach over here. It's depending. Elemental Weapon is going to be more damage in itself and the burst, as I talked about before, but this is not going to proc the enchant, so Force Pulse, of course, will do that, so it's a good option here as well. And Reach is a CC. Now, I don't want to run Reach most of the time, simply because my teammates have better CCs than I will have, even with Reach. So that's why I prefer to run an Force Pulse or Elemental Weapon. The ultimate on the front bar is Soul Assault, simply because I think it synergizes well with the Icy Rage here. If you have a high amount of ultimate, I use this. If I just want to do a quick finisher or whatever, I use Soul Assault over here. As you can see, it's a pretty cheap ultimate. Also, in NoCP, people are generally squishier, and if they mess up like one thing, like one roll dodge, this thing is going to kill them quicker than in the CP campaigns. For potions, again, I have the spell power potions and the tripods, and the food that I use is the regular tri-stat food. Now, for this last part of the video, I just want to mention a few extra general things, a few item sets, etc. that I didn't mention, and some general ideas. Starting off with the Alfvik set, you might have noticed that I've never used this in any of my builds. If you don't know directly what Alfvik is, it's the magicka version of Hulking Draugr. But yeah, so it's a good set for magicka, and every time I mention a build with Praetor's Burst and the Infusion Drink, it is a viable option to run the Alfvik and Trastad Food instead. The difference is that the first setup is going to give you more regeneration and thus more spell damage if you switch the enchants a little bit, while keeping a high max magicka, and the second setup is going to give you more health and stamina. Now, I prefer the first simply because I value the regeneration, etc. higher than health and the stamina. In all the builds I presented, I have enough of health and stamina in order to play the respective playstyles that I have. So that is a big reason why I prefer Alfika. I just don't really need the extra stats in health and stamina that it gives. Another set that I definitely need to mention is the Armor Master set. It's not as popular as it was in Murkmire, for example, this patch, but it is still a very good beginner set, I think. Simply because, well, if you're just starting out, you don't have the shield stacking on point yet, and you probably need an extra safety net, so Armor Master is definitely a good option then. But I do recommend that as you progress through the game, you swap Armor Master out for Lich eventually. Simply because Lich is going to give you more regen than Armor Master gives in resistances. Lich is just a more valuable set in terms of stats. Another interesting change that ZeniMax has done in the Elsewhere patch is the Race Against Time Morph buff. Now it's going to give you a small snare and root immunity, which is useful for most Magicka builds, I think. It's definitely something worth using, but for Magicka Sorcerer, I do not think it's advisable to use that, simply because you do not need the snare immunity as much as you would on other classes. Magicka Sorcerer can kite perfectly fine without it. And even if you would slot it, you would run into bar space problems, like you will most likely drop Boundless for it, which can be countered by running the Tuned Monster set, of course, but that means that you will sacrifice a monster set for those like 2 seconds of snare and root immunity, which I do not think is worth it, especially for the Magicka Sorcerer. Another thing that I didn't use in my builds is the Bloody Mara drink, which is basically going to give you, well, a huge amount of health and Magicka, but no stamina. That is simply because of how these stats turn out in the end when you use this thing, because if you use Bloody Mara, you will have to go with the Tristat enchant, the prismatic enchant on the armor as well, in order to get, well, a decently sized stamina pool. Now, the problem with that is that you will get over 30k health, like, easily with a build like that. And while such a huge amount of health is definitely going to help with the general tankiness, it's going to protect against ganks a little bit as well, I'd rather have those stats into regeneration, Magicka, or damage, simply because I value those more. I am fine in terms of survivability without having 30k health, and I think the regeneration that the Tristat drink gives in stamina is going to be much more useful than the maximum health. Now, something I was asked a lot is what kind of addons that I use for PvP. Now, here you can see my addon list, but most of these are not PvP specific. There's only 3 that are really important, which is the Greymount Quickslot Bar. Now, that addon is to be able to switch potions with a simple click, instead of having to use the scroll wheel. If you can see the potion bar right now, you see I can just switch through them with a click. If I have to use the wheel over here, it's clumsy, I think, to use that in middle of combat, so that's why I've got this addon. The second addon that I use is the Pontificator addon over here. That is simply to keep track of the killstreak that I have and the current time that I played. The main reason for this is to know how well I did after I died, and also for editing purposes, it's useful to see when there's like a big burst of kills in the footage that I recorded. Then the last addon that I have for combat is the Surrender addon. I'm using this as the buff tracking addon for Boundless Storm, Surge and Elemental Drain. In open world, only Boundless Storm is on, of course, and it's quite useful simply to see when I have to recast it. It allows me to have a larger uptime if I would choose to have it. Now, something that's a bit related is the tap target mechanic that's still in the game. The cycle preferred enemy over here. It is something that I wish to be trying again at this patch. I haven't done so yet because, well, I simply didn't have the time, but it is on my to-do list, and I definitely recommend you to try it as well. Simply because I think this is going to be a huge help with burst combos that involve streak, because of course if you streak and then you turn your camera instantly, sometimes the relative positions of the enemy have changed, and to have some sort of marker that shows where the enemy is and is going to like prefer projectiles being cast towards. And of course, this thing is also going to allow you to see enemies that are behind LOS, so it's quite useful, regardless. Then a last thing I want to mention before I finish this video is just a general thing about build crafting. I have presented like a couple of good builds, I think personally, but this is definitely not all of it in the game. There's so much more to try out. As I mentioned before, there are other sets that you can use, and it's really easy to get new ideas for builds for any class and also for Magicka Sorcerer in this game. I'm just going to give you a quick example of something I thought of earlier today, which is a build that uses the new potions that they added with the lingering health and minor heroism. Well, the idea is that the lingering health is going to allow me to drop healing ward, and then I can run that in combination with surge to have a really good heal over time. And then the heroism that these potions are going to give is going to allow me, hopefully, to have a permanent Aatrox uptime. I mean, especially with Bloodspawn, this should be possible. And I can then combine it with the Necropotent set, maybe. But you can see how many options there are for a build. Obviously, like with this kind of setup, I'm going to miss out on the major Magicka Regeneration buff. I can probably make up for that with a simple enchant. But yeah, you see, it's just another idea of things that you can run. The amount of builds that you can craft is quite huge in this game, and I do advise you think for yourself while you are playing it. So yeah, with that idea, I want to leave you to it. Thank you for watching this guide. I hope you learned something at least. So I don't think I'll be presenting any more builds this patch for the Magicka Sorcerer. This, I think, is quite conclusive for what I will be running. But yeah, I hope you enjoyed the video, like and subscribe, etc. And see you guys next time.